Okay, and welcome back. Hour number three. It's Monday, and that means, as you know, our Fukushima update with Yoichi Shimatsu. Can you hear me all right?
Yeah, it's our ongoing telephone problems. You know, don't seem to have any problems anywhere else, only on this one particular connection. You know, it's very strange, you know, that everything else works, except our connection between where you're at and where I'm at. It just doesn't make any sense at all.
Seems like there's a very high percentage.
I think they've got to upgrade their technology, obviously. You know, then, one thing, surveillance is one thing, but, you know, interference is another, because then the phone companies get involved internationally, you know, it all gets convoluted. And
exactly.
Governments in Asia starting to wonder what's going on here. You can't make a phone call between here and there. And does it just only affect us discussing radiation issues, but does this all involve trade secrets, personal secrets of politicians and bankers, private phone calls of these sort of people? So it's a cause of concern, you know, that there's so much active, or let's say there's so much poor phone service whenever one discusses certain issues. And certain issues are a broad range of issues, of course.
Doggone. It's a heck of a coincidence, isn't it?
It is. It just happens every week. I just don't, you know, it's something I just can't seem to understand, because everywhere else, you know, it's
no problem.
Not a perfect connection. So what person's next door, halfway around the world, and tell what's next door.
Here's the
the
latest.
Continue.
From Fukushima Daiichi Reactor 4. Glory be, as they say over here, the Reactor 4 spent fuel pool's cooling system has gone offline. It stopped working. It's all breaking down.
Right, exactly. This is the one where the building looks perfectly fine from inside. In fact, not only did NHK report a visit there, Yomiuri Shimbun, you know, this was they sent a team there. Everything looks just perfect to them, peacekeeping. Even though Yomiuri Group, if you remember, was related to Nippon TV, which did all the pro-nuclear propaganda during the 1950s, and the head of the group happened to be on the payroll of the CIA. Okay, Japanese Media Corporation, all documented by a professor at Waseda University, you know, a renowned historian. So basically, we have a newspaper with long his pro-nuclear history going inside, sending a team into what is allegedly the reactor force spent fuel pool, giving it all okay. And now we're finding out technical problems. Just astounding how they lead us by the, you know, like a ring through the nose.
It's true.
Just pulling that ring and leading the media around. And then, boom, all of a sudden, problems. They've got to alert their staff and all that, you know, not to get close. So, therefore, this reached out to the media.
Yeah.
It just goes on and on and on and on. The circuit just never ends. It's just going on and on and on. And you think by now they would have their act together. You know,
no.
They would know how to run a cover.
No. In fact, the more we learn about...
Now, they know how to run it.
Right. The more we learn about TEPCO, the more the professionals describe TEPCO as being beyond incompetent. It's that bad. Which is what we've been telling people
for three years.
I've
met engineers there and workers. They're a dedicated bunch. They're professional. So obviously the incompetence is not...
No, not at the ground level. It's at the top.
Of the workforce. No, it's at the top. Yeah, there's countermandering orders. Should we have to be open and release more information? We need this information so we get more money from the government, because if everything is too nice there, the government's not going to give us money. So therefore, we have to have some sense of crisis there. Oh, hold it. Now, that's too much crisis. So they're constantly jiggling, you know, that little up and down lever on crisis management. And so the information is countermanded every week. It's sort of a nightmarish situation for anyone observing.
Oh, exactly.
And as the weeks go on, and we still don't really get a clear picture of what exactly really is happening. That, of course, nobody who is unbiased has ever visited this place. It's always media that's been very tightly controlled pro-nuclear media. Unfortunately, NHK, the national TV broadcaster, has switched under their new general director from a critical balanced, news service into something that is, madly so pro-nuclear now under him, they don't know which way to turn, which way to go. They don't know how to report the news anymore.
Well, whatever the news is.
So that's the situation. Another crisis.
Yeah, well, we got one over here. Yeah. They have this nuclear storage facility in New Mexico called the WIPP, yeah, the WIP site. And Carlsbad, New Mexico, is about 21 miles away. 10th largest city in New Mexico. Well, guess what they're detecting in Carlsbad now? Radioactivity.
Yeah, very disturbing. You know, there's a lot of crisis points everywhere. It's just leakages everywhere. I mean, basically, the whole nuclear infrastructure
is rotting
all around the world.
It's breaking down, Yoshi. It has to. They only had useful lives of 30 years or thereabout, and they're into their 45th year. Some of them, it's old. They're falling apart. This is a nuclear storage facility. And actually, the word that I'm able to discern, and some of you have seen, is that the roof of this thing fell in and actually punctured a number of these highly toxic 55-gallon drums full of radioactive waste. And that's the source of the problem.
Yeah.
And they don't know what the hell to do about it. They can't just send the SEALs in there to go in there and, go in there with this duct tape and tape up all those crushed and broken drums.
Right. Yeah, and just the idea that these 55, the drums that you use to search airplane fuel and kerosene, is nuclear storage, and you throw that into a cage.
Pretty high tech, huh?
Exactly. This is it, folks. This is going to last for the next couple hundred thousand years. You've got to be kidding. I mean, this industry has really deluded itself, not just deluded the public, deluded itself in thinking that these Band-Aid solutions are going to last more than a dozen years or so. So, yeah, typical problem. The crisis is breaking out all over the United States, and all we've got is denial coming out of the power companies, out of the government, out of the scientific community, which is supposed to be, the sanctity of science. Science is supposed to be objective, neutral, not being influenced by politics. Just lay out the facts.
Objective?
And we're just not getting any kind of clear story at all.
Objective? Neutral?
And then,
Not when you have grants involved.
Yep. Not when you have the National Science Foundation, the Department of Energy, the Environment Department. They're all, financing the labs, and the labs. It's not just the money for the research, but it's also promotion. If you don't do the research, publish or perish, if you don't get the money to run these exotic tests, you end up being an associate professor at a state college in somewhere like, Iowa or somewhere, completely irrelevant in the Department of 10 people. Otherwise, you go to the top. Places like Woods Hole, for example, that wonderful laboratory that just told us, that just reported us, the radiation is starting to hit the California, is about to hit the California coast, as if it's not already hit, that the levels are so low at the 8 measuring stations along British Columbia coast, Canadian coast, Washington and Oregon and California, that there's nothing to worry about. This is just, way below safety. This is the report they give. Now, and also in Canada, the report's being done by the Bedford lab, oceanic lab. And that's out in Newfoundland. In other words, these major laboratories would do all their analysis. They collect the information from West Coast field, field studies. They do all the processing on the East Coast right near the major defense facilities of the United States and Canada, the naval defense facilities there. And they determine that there's no real risk on the entire West Coast of North America. So there's already something is suspect there. There's plenty of top research universities along the West Coast in British Columbia, in Washington, in California, Oregon. Why does the data have to be processed near the capital, basically, of both countries?
Oh, yeah.
It's obviously clear the closer to the politicians, the better, okay? Stuff's obviously being vetted. So They are taking these tests. They haven't announced. They said there's 8 measuring centers, you know, along the coast. They haven't disclosed us where, who, how far out to sea these tests are being done. And they make these radically sweeping conclusions that the stuff is so dilute. And as we know, dilute water, it's less of exposure. It's not just the dilution. You know, you can get a short burst of radiation, or you can get just constant low doses exposure, so-called low dose exposure. That will be equally deadly. And the sea animals are obviously a sign that so-called dilution of nuclear waste from Fukushima is enough to wipe out entire, you know, subspecies, if not the whole species. So this gives us no reassurance at all as the methodology that's being used. And the one in Newfoundland is called Bedford, the Bedford Lab. I would prefer to call it the Bedlam Lab. Bedlam, you know?
Agreed.
Bedlam, nuts, you know what I mean, right? Psychiatric institutions, because our scientists have got to be nuts to issue these kind of cover-up reports and believe their credibility is going to last, you know, throughout this decade. So, terrible situation we're getting with scientific fraud, overt scientific fraud being perpetrated. You know, the data that one surfer has collected off the coast of San Mateo County has been, you know, it is astounding. That's the only reliable source.
Well, he's actually not, he's a little older. He's not surfing anymore, but he knows the area extremely well. He's very bright, and he's put up a wonderful live, you can go see it, radiation station. It's linked right to our radiation box. And I'd urge you to go and take a look.
That is a credible testing station on record where it is, who's running it, and he's providing data, video feeds. These other 8 mysterious field collection points, not telling us which universities are involved, which departments, which scientists are involved, so we can get them on record and go out there and double check, cross check. Okay? We usually use, this is part of scientific method, you have to duplicate some of these. You know, someone's got to go out there and independently and say, okay, our data's pretty much close to that. Nothing like that's happening. So we're getting reassurances, but with no real feeling that any of this is credible. You know, and it's federal government. This is top-level people, massively funded. We just cannot. I mean, what can we believe anymore? We've gone through all this. So while many experts are ready to hit TEPCO, it seems the whole scientific establishment down the line is corrupted, not just TEPCO. They're all under political influence. They're all giving up, you know, cock and bull stories. Yeah. So it's just astounding.
It truly is astounding, and I hope all of you are keeping up to date. If you care to, if you don't, that's certainly your choice. We're giving you the best information we possibly can. The radiation plume is really a misleading term because it's an entire mass of the North Pacific. It's not just a plume. Yes, there are stringers in it. There are varying areas of different concentrations of these radionuclides, but the entire North Pacific is contaminated. And again, you can go 5 miles one way, it may be less, it may be more, it changes. But that entire mass has taken 3 years to move across, right, from west to the east, and it's just about to hit. The model showed it took 3.2 years to 3.9 years to get here after the problem. But we're coming up on 3 years. So we may have a couple of months, 3 months left to go before the main part of it hits here. But keep this in mind. The EPA knows exactly, precisely what's going on. They are measuring the water in the ocean, the air at different elevations, the water at different depths. They're on this. They're all over this. They're measuring the beaches. They're measuring the coastal marine layer. They're measuring everything. They're not telling us anything either. Nothing. When you see total silence like we're seeing, total silence, you know there's a cover-up. It's a no-brainer. They're not lying. They're not saying anything. It's called the lie of omission. No. They're not telling us anything. So we have to do it ourselves, and do it we will.
Well, they're saying this very strange thing, that they're detecting a lot more cesium-137 in the water than cesium-134, which would normally be more prevalent. 137 is usually associated I hope I'm not mistaken about it, because my branch of chemistry was much more benign than this radiation chemistry. You know, I stayed away from this sort of deadly topic.
Right.
But I believe that 137 is more associated with more powerful, radioactive elements. So it's very enriched uranium.
Right. It apparently only comes primarily from the actual melting down of a reactor core. That's the primary source of this kind of a nuclide. And 137 is worse than 134. You're right.
Yeah, and that is drifting across. And then the rate of dilution.
But we're getting straight. Yoshi, excuse me. We're getting, it's not just the 137. It's almost all strontium now that's coming out of that place. And that's on its way over here.
They did not mention strontium.
They leave it out.
Tritium or any other element. Yeah, there's all sorts of heavy metal stuff that would be coming over in the algae. A lot of that would be absorbed by algae and streaming across. Are they filtering out the water? Are they filtering the water? They're not telling us any crucial information. So the reports are completely inadequate. They're nearly unscientific when they just throw out these statements, very diluted. And of course, billions of tons of water coming across. So basically, even at a low rate of dilution, if all that was like solid material, it would be like someone dropping 100 kilograms, on the west coast of,
exactly right.
Yeah, you see what I'm saying? If it was undiluted, we know that radiation, it lasts a long time. It's going to be around. The west coast is going to, the beaches are going to be basically unswimmable, and you're not going to be able to have. So we're not getting a real picture of what's really going on, and no scientist really wants to break this down. Explain to the public how bad it is. They just go, it's dilute, don't worry. As if we're going to drink that water, okay?
Yeah.
What does dilution mean when the seawater hits the coast, it evaporates and leaves radionuclides on the beaches and the mudflats, and then the biological and the food chain? That's the information we need to know, not whether how diluted it is. So this is very irresponsible on their part. So basically, call it popular science or whatever. You've got to break down the science into numbers, into facts that is relevant to the lives of the people who live on the West Coast, people who live in inland, to farmers, to household people who are going to get the rain clouds that are radioactive and water their lawns, take baths, and drink the stuff. We've got to get a little more of a concrete picture. What does this mean for average people? And this is also a role of science. I just can't see how they can just say it's dilute. Don't worry about it. So you can drink a couple. Go in the ocean. Take a swim. You gulp down a few swallows. It won't hurt you. Granted, that might be true, but it's irrelevant when millions of tons are being evaporated off on the beaches and leaving.
And remember, it just it keeps on rolling in. It's not going to stop. Here's a story that I had a day or two ago. We got a new map, and it reveals tests from May a year ago, so 10 months ago. And the tests show that the radioactive plume, right? Now think of this, is over 3,000 miles wide as of May 2013. The plume, or the polluted, contaminated, toxic, radioactive part of the ocean, down to, 150 meters, 500 feet total, is over 3,000 miles wide. This is as of May in 2013. Now, this only includes the most contaminated area in the Pacific, with cesium more than 7 becquerels per square meter. And you can look at the test results. The story is up there. I'll just read this. We have to take a break here, but very briefly. April 15th, 2013, at a depth of 500 feet, cesium-137, 4.8 becquerels per square meter, cesium-134, 4.0 becquerels per square meter. And on April the 17th, at a depth of 150 feet, much more shallow, cesium-137, 4.5 becquerels per square meter. April the 28th, at a depth of none, zero, top of the water, 4.6 becquerels per square meter. So you have down to 500 feet, three testing depths. at the surface, 150 feet, and 500 feet down. At the surface, 4.6 becquerels per square meter, 150 feet, 4.5, at 500 feet, 4.8 becquerels per square meter. So you can see the pollution is very thoroughly distributed down to a depth of 500 feet, talking about this one radionuclide, cesium-137. The readout on the cesium-134 is lower, about 25% lower in concentration, maybe 30%, but it's still there. Hold on a minute, we'll come right back. Okay, let's get right back to it. Now, keep in mind that I have yet to see a single competent scientific professional announcement or press release by the EPA about any of this. I may have missed it. I can't find anything. Maybe there have been one or two, don't worry, be happy, press releases. That's about it. I've got another thing up here. Fukushima radiation blasted us airborne in March of 2011. There's no question about it. It came over in the air within days. I tasted it. I had to deal with it. At the whole West Coast from Seattle all the way down to L.A. got the heart of this enormous cloud of varying concentrations and densities of radionuclides, and it just nailed us. Did you hear anything from the government about that? Not a damned word. Nothing. Now here's another one that's up there. You can find it in the Fukushima box in the right-hand column. It's Fukushima radiation plume nears West Coast, graphs and video. Now, this is very interesting because it is, as I said a few minutes ago, they know how long it takes for the mass of contaminated water to make the transit, right, from west to east. Based on the statistics of surface drifter data. Oh, let me go back to the cesium-137 results I was reading earlier. Keep in mind, and I've been telling you this for a long time, that they're testing the water down to about 150 meters. It's around 500 feet. Now, you heard proof, I read it to you, that that is correct, and the water is almost evenly dispersed in terms of radionuclides down to 500 feet as it's coming across. That's pretty deep. Based on the statistics of surface drifter data of 1979 to the year 2011 and the simulation of nuclear pollutant particulate movements simulated using high-quality ocean reanalysis surface current data set, the transport pathways and the impact strength of Fukushima nuclear pollutants in the North Pacific have now been estimated. The particulates are used to increase the sampling size and enhance the representativeness of the statistical results. Most pollutant particles move eastward and are carried, that means toward us, and are carried by the Kuroshio and the Kuroshio extension currents and reach the east side of the North Pacific, that's us folks, the West Coast, after about 3.2 to 3.9 years. So it's not here quite yet, but it's very close. Go ahead, Yoshi.
Yeah, well, you know, there's some things about this depth. It's 500 feet. You know, that I assume that's a lowest point of measurement that they could
see. That's exactly right.
It's not very clear.
That's right.
Whether these are, you know, helicopter, you know, are these measuring instruments being, you know, tied to cables from helicopters? Are they done from ships? You know, what types of ships? It would be nice if they let us know who's doing the measuring, how it's done, and whether 500 feet means that's just as far down as they can go. Maybe it goes deeper. Anyway, when you get 150 meters deep, and, you know, and pretty consistent, you would assume it would go deeper. The other thing is that when it comes toward the coast, as it moves toward the beaches, the sea, you know, the seabed rises up, you know, along the continental shelf, up to the coast. So basically all that water becomes more and more concentrated, moves up much more rapidly. And so what's down at 500 feet will be coming up on shore. So, you know, we shouldn't kid ourselves. It just disappears somewhere. it gets reconcentrated close to shore. So, I, again, there's just zero explanation of what all this data really means for us. We can, we can just surmise that the radiation will go stronger as it gets concentrated up to shore, and it'll collect in places like estuaries. It'll be pushed in by the tide into estuaries, which are very close to human habitation, mixing with fresh water, where fishes breed, and where the breeding grounds for fishes, birds, other wildlife. So, you know, we're not getting any kind of real picture. What does this mean on the shore, on the ground? What else? So I think this is really what's missing, and it's the duty of science, as we scientists, to work together in an interdisciplinary way and tell us.
Well, so far their only answer is Kelp Watch 2014, that bogus study of kelp, which will take about a year to accomplish, and as we know, is going to be analyzed by one man and his team at UC Berkeley, and who already announced the results of the test before it even began. So, look, folks.
We've already measured kelp months and months ago. What's taking them so long? You know,
right.
So I don't know.
And we've already found cesium in it. Now, four becquerels per square.
Plenty of radiation.
Yeah, four becquerels per square meter.
Try the mollusks, the snails on the shore that eat the algae. Fantastically high radiation.
That's it.
It's already here, you know. I mean, I don't know what they're watching for. Where have they been? What are they doing? You know,
And is anybody asking? Nobody's asking.
Not in government, not in scientific circles. I mean, you have major, let's say, research universities out there along the West Coast, environmental studies department. What are they doing other than, you know, pushing this, once again, this global warming theory upon us? You know, I mean, so they're all single-minded to point everything to carbon dioxide, which probably is a bad thing. You know, carbon dioxide, not a good thing, while ignoring radiation right there on their front porch, lapping up against the shore. At least this Woods Hole study did say 2016 is going to be a peak. I would dispute that.
A peak? I dispute that completely. It's not going to be a peak at all.
It will mean that the radiation will continue to rise. Okay,
that's right.
This is the point.
That's right.
Whether it diminishes is another question, because radiation is constantly being pushed off of the Japanese coast. So peak is kind of wrong. It gives the impression it's going to go back down to zero. It's not. It's going to remain at best a plateau of some sort as more and more
at
radioactive water pushes in. So this is all very disturbing. Again, we're not getting any kind of picture that people can comprehend, and the assumption is that this is going to go down. No, the crisis is not going to go away. I mean, there still remains danger, more meltdown. There's not danger. Meltdowns are happening as we speak. They continue to happen under the surface of the soil, so underground. So, we're nearly. That's like astonishing. How can the scientists? How can these major research universities let us down so badly? I mean,
they want their grants.
What took
so long?
What took so long? Yeah, exactly. What took so long? And why are they pulling their punches when they should be, alerting people to this danger that's going on? The danger, And again, the lack of interpretation. Just the always saying it's a low dosage, nothing to worry about, below our safety limits. This is just not true.
Poet, remember the expression.
And what does it mean?
Poses no danger to the public. That's their favorite line.
Yeah, exactly. And what this leads to is policies like now the Japanese government is reversing its energy policy from all nuclear plants will be shut down in 30 decades. That will be their target for decommissioning of all nuclear and phasing out. Now to nuclear forms part an important part of Japan's energy picture. Okay? In other words, the plants stay. They're going to come back on. New plants to be built. So that's what bad science does. It makes the situation far worse. It's not like a neutral thing that affects the health of a few people. It means they're basically giving the foundation, the argument, the logic for continuance of nuclear energy and going right back to where we started before the nuclear Fukushima blast. With virtually no changes whatsoever. Safety standards or in technology or anything like that. So it's just status quo. Keep the status quo and damn the fascists. Full speed ahead. Never mind the torpedoes. Just full speed ahead right into this Armageddon moment.
You know, did you see the story? I'm sure you did. That the big leak a few days ago out of one of the storage tanks was caused by a valve that had been turned open. Somebody turned a valve on and let that water out. And in that water was 12 trillion becquerels of strontium-90. And that's about 1/8 the total release of strontium-90 since 3/11. Just one tank, one mistake, and it's going right into the ground, and the groundwater will push it right out in the ocean. They're going to dump all of those tanks in the ocean, all of them, sooner or later.
Yeah. Well, this isn't some deliberate act of terrorism by disgruntled workers. This is management saying, we run out of tank space. Let's open up more space. We got to, keep cooling these reactors, put the water somewhere. We're out of room for tanks, we don't have time to build more. The radioactive buildup is massive here. So let's find more tank space. And some guy, a field manager out there says, okay, you need tank space, we give you tank space, right? I mean, this is...
That's what it sounds like happening.
Rogue workers or something. Exactly. They need more storage space for the water that's constantly being pumped through to keep the reactors and the other facilities cool. It's got to go somewhere. It goes in a tank. So how do you create tanks based on all the tanks are full and no one, new ones are under construction?
And the tanks only have a 5-year life expectancy to begin with. They're steel. They're already rusting. They're 2.5
they're
years
really
through.
Have
their,
a tank
they're fine.
Exactly. Really going to have a big problem ahead. Not clear at all. That's why I'm skeptical about a peak in 2016. If all the tanks are going to go down within 5 years, it means the peak is long. It's way down the road. This stuff is going to continue dumping Pacific, continue coming across the West Coast, and maybe low dosage at first diluted, but as fish, marine mammals, as seacoast communities are just constantly hit for years, for decades. All that so-called dilute stuff is going to build up. And again, the water just doesn't turn down the coast and back out to the Pacific. It goes down the west coast of the United States, lands on the beaches, and as you sit on the beach, you see the waves come up. Low tide, it goes back down. Low tide, the beach dries up, turns to soft white sand, and that radiation is building up. Not just beaches, along the harbors, estuaries, all over, mudflats, all over. The process is massive, just incredible buildup of radioactive material along North America. It's a real urgent crisis, and all we're getting is whitewashes right now. We're not getting anything close to a real serious examination of this challenge ahead, what people can do about it. And residents in coastal communities are worried. Well, they have reasons to be worried. If you have property there, you have boats out there, you have every good reason to worry. You're not getting a straight story here. You're not getting any kind of projection. Nothing really, factually based. The facts are just being belittled. And so, it's really disheartening. It's hard. And you just wish people like Dave down there, the surfer, and myself could just sign off. We've exposed ourselves enough. But the science community is not stepping up the bat. They're not doing what they've got to do, what they're paid to do.
They're not doing much of anything. And it's not going to change.
Yeah, they're just protecting their grant
story. That's all it is.
So really, tough situation for all the rest of us to face this contamination, growing contamination, getting harder and harder all the time. Japan really clobbered by radiation right now, with the recent snowfall. And now the snow melt that follows. Again, no clear data of what's happening in the rivers. The Japanese people.
The rivers are the silt in the bottom of your rivers, the mud.
It's in the drinking water, farmland.
No one's talking about it. Keep in mind the key word to this whole thing: 4 becquerels per square meter. Not much, but we're talking about bioaccumulation over time, And the plume, so-called plume, 3,000 miles wide, is not going to go away. We know it's down to at least 500 feet with about the same concentration as at the surface. That's an enormous testimonial to how this stuff has gone into the ocean. It could be down to 1,500, 2,000 feet. Nobody knows. They only released the results down to 500 feet. So it's going to keep coming.
All we know is that even at low concentration, we're talking about hundreds and hundreds. I mean, it's an inconceivable amount of material. If you took the sum total, comes flowing across the Pacific through the water in the air. And what you mentioned about the radiation, you know, hitting the West Coast, you know, within days. If you recall back when we talked back then after, in April, May, 2011, the officials were saying, oh, well, this clouds of radiation, they're not going to hit North America for at least 3 weeks. By then, it will be very diluted, you know, and all this. Same old story. I mean, I think you recall. We were just
grotesque. I do recall.
And we said, no, well,
Yep.
Yeah, there, well, people are picking up massive radiation in days, and it's traveling more quickly. The later scientists came out with this idea. There are these rivers of wind. You know, there's a jet stream, but also below that, these very fast-moving rivers of wind, you know, air rivers.
Yep.
That are bringing the radiation across at super, you know, really very incredibly fast speed.
Well, three days after the explosions, they were pinned. After reactor 3 blew up, they picked up plutonium in New Mexico 3 days afterward. That's it.
Yep.
They had a signature
incredible
to it. They could tell it was Fukushima. Yeah.
Yeah. See the movement. So the stuff is far beyond anything they ever imagined. It's more pervasive. It moves faster. It gets into biosystems. It's very hard to decontaminate anything. You know, not easy.
Let's just say it's virtually
decontamination.
It's virtually impossible to thoroughly decontaminate. Yeah. It's almost impossible.
Right. And right now, the city of Tokyo is preparing for the Olympics. They don't dare decontaminate. You know, messy guys in safety suits, you know, with sprayers on every house in Tokyo, apartment blocks, parking lots, gardens, you know, digging up the garden, you know, and taking away the dirt to somewhere, who knows where, incinerating all the trash and all the billboards, tearing down billboards. You know, they don't dare, if Tokyo did have these high levels, I mean, not this if, they did, it did have extremely high levels of radioactive contamination with some snow that hit every ledge, every surface. They've got to decontaminate now during the snowmelt. They got to get the stuff out. Don't let it dry and harden. You know? Don't let it, but they're not doing that because they don't dare put on the show of a massive decontamination in Tokyo. You know, so basically, the Olympics are cooked. Okay? They're cooked. It's over. I mean, I think if the IOC continues with this, every member of the International Olympic Committee. There should be criminal charges filed against it to allow athletes to go in there, go swimming in this stuff. Just absurd. So, pure sheer politics of a pro-nuclear candidate winning the governorship there. You know, he's not going to do decontamination at the city while hosing down this entire city and letting everything rush down to Tokyo Bay, where the Olympics are going to be held, where Olympics still is going to be built. Because I think the safety of the 10 million residents, 12 million residents, that of Greater Tokyo, right now, means you should wash everything down, let it go down Tokyo Bay. There's nowhere else it can go. But they're not going to do that. They're just going to let the residents do this radiation so that the Olympic image will clean Tokyo. Environmentally.
I can't understand.
Environmentally. Olympics will go on.
Sooner or later, well, unfortunately, the drive for most Olympic athletes is fame and maybe fortune, conquering a life's dream, making it your own. I don't know, but it would be nice to see some of the athletes say, no, I will not compete there. But they're not going to. They'll be replaced in a minute.
Look what happened to the U.S. Navy sailors, their lawsuit, you know, against the ones who were, you know, clearly, undoubtedly, hit on the Ranger, on the George Washington, on the supercarriers, and the other vessels.
Yeah.
Not to mention all the helicopters and planes that were flying over. Trucks of all the support services the U.S. military gave to the tsunami effort. They basically been trashed by the Pentagon. Pentagon got what it wants. They guilt tripped Japan about the radiation. Got the base deal in Okinawa. That's enough. Now let the sailors go. Go retire. Go find another job. How insanely disloyal the government is to its most loyal, loyal citizens. It's just appalling how they're just ready to write off, hundreds of thousands of American servicemen. And on top of the millions and millions of Japanese, who are affected by this, just write them off. They don't matter. Don't file a lawsuit. No compensation. No medical care. Just get lost. Okay. This is the attitude that prevails now. I'm totally unconscionable, totally irresponsible. How can one industry, the nuclear industry, have that much power over government? I don't know. And that's a question people are going to have to go over. Why is the nuclear industry so powerful? Why
it's a very good question.
The myth of nuclear power, this enormous myth, this golem, I call it, this man-made monster, this Frankenstein's creation, how is it allowed to rumble around, do whatever it wants, destroy whatever it wants, wreck people's lives, make them horribly sick? How come no one in government dares challenge them? This is what I can't understand. And I've talked about it before. This is a product of Kabbalist science, of a cosmology, of a certain cosmology, which people in the Hindu world, the Buddhist world, certainly do not agree with that cosmology. They're victims of that cosmology right now. Places like Japan, Mongolia, China, Korea, they're all victims of a totally foreign cosmology for them. They had nothing to do with developing the nuclear bomb. And they're the victims of this quest for power, this quest for unlimited power to split the atom. And there has to be some fundamental questions asked about this whole nuclear theory, the entire nuclear physics establishment. What is this all really all about? This quest for power, quest for supreme, infinite power. What is this? Is man playing God? Is that what's really happening here? Man made in the image of God, who now wants to become God himself. I mean, is this what's really going on? No one dares ask these questions of why this has such supreme power over the government of the United States, of Britain, of France, of Japan. See, this question has to be raised. Why is nuclear power, sacrosanct? Why is it immune from justice? Why is it immune from, economic?
It's completely immune. I agree. Now, keep in mind that respect for the military, and you can see, by the way, we this country treat our veterans with such disdain and contempt. How dare you ask for help? Yeah. 6 months to get in if you can see somebody. Henry Kissinger, one of his most infamous quotes, this is a true quote, said, "Military men are just dumb, stupid animals to be used as pawns in foreign policy." End quote.
Mm-hmm.
There you go. It's all right there. Mm-hmm. So you folks who are thinking about going into the military, I would implore you to think twice and then think again. They will tear your life up and toss it in the trash can. They don't care.
You certainly have the right and the duty to defend, the responsible duty to defend your country, but not defend the politicians. It's tragic what's going on. It's just tragic the fact that there is no justice for the sailors, for the armed services.
There won't be any either.
All the
no. No, they're already being told their suit
justice.
Is going nowhere. Exactly. Yochi, thank you as always. We'll see what happens. Talk to you next Monday. Take care of yourself.
All right.
Okay. Night. All right. There we go. Monday. We're off and running. And we are in the last week of February. That's amazing. Okay. See you tomorrow night in 21 hours. Lots to think about. And do take care. We'll talk to you tomorrow night.